The year is 1904. Our proud nation is about to suffer one of its greatest cultural insults at the hand of the German critic, Oscar Adolf Hermann Schmitz.
I have asked myself what is missing from this nation. I have found something which distinguishes English people from all other cultures to quite an astonishing degree. The English are the only cultured nation without its own music.
I'm going to tell you a story of the men and women who refused to accept this slight, who set out on a mission to rediscover the soul of our island, and in doing so, revealed a river of ancient song flowing through it.
Come all you young subjects and listen a while.
All over the country, in rural and industrial settings, people were singing. From factory workers to farmers, from travellers to fishermen, age-old ballads of love and loss passed down through the generations. To hear these old songs is to hear the sonic prehistory of our ancient lineage, a form of singing that's no longer part of our cultural education.
Oh, come father, come father, build to me a bow.
This is music unshackled from commerce. It exists outside of the industry. This is feral song. It lives in the wild.
I'm going to fly.
I'm a singer. I sing the old songs. I'm also a collector, part of a long line of those who've sought to document and record the traditional songs of the British Isles before they fade into the fog of the past, obscured by the onset of modern culture. The dawn of the 20th century witnessed a revival of interest in English traditional music, sparked in part by the desire to combat the sentiment of Europeans like Schmitz, who said England was a land without music. Those interested in what they called folk music knew that England was awash with singers of authentic traditional songs dating back many hundreds of years. They also knew that these old songs were under threat. It was at the first meeting of the Folk Song Society in 1899 that Director of the Royal College of Music, Sir Hubert Parry, issued a stark warning about the impending fate of British folk music.
There is an enemy at the doors of folk music, which is driving it out, namely the common popular songs of the day. And this enemy is one of the most repulsive and most insidious. If one thinks of the outer circumference of our terribly overgrown towns, where the jerry builder holds sway, where one sees all around the tawdriness of sham jewellery and shoddy clothes, pawn shops and gin palaces, where stale fish and the miserable piles of Covent Garden refuse which pass for vegetables are offered for food, all such things suggest to one's mind the boundless regions of sham.
Parry, who 17 years later would compose the musical setting for William Blake's Jerusalem, was in no doubt who was to blame for this attack on the nation's folk songs.
It is for the people who live in these unhealthy regions, people who for the most part have the most false ideals or none at all, who are always struggling for existence, who think that the commonest rowdyism is the highest expression of the human condition. It is for them that the modern popular music is made, and it is made with a commercial intention out of snippets of musical slang. And it is this product that will drive out folk music if we do not save it.
So to trace the history of those who fought to save folk music in Britain, I've come to the epicentre of traditional music research, the Vaughan Williams Memorial Library in Cecil Sharp House, home of the English Folk Dance and Song Society, which traces its roots back to Parry's inaugural address at the end of the 19th century.
We're in the Vaughan Williams Memorial Library here in Tessel Sharp House, and I'm sitting next to Laura Smith, the Library and Archive Director. Laura, thank you for having us.
That's a pleasure.
It's always wonderful to be in this room. So this library is part of Cecil Sharp House. I'm wondering if you can tell us a bit about who Cecil Sharp was and how does he fit into the whole story of song collecting and its journey?
Cecil Sharp is the most famous of English folk song collectors. He wasn't the first folk song collector, but he was the most prolific in terms of how much material he actually went out and gathered. So he collected just under 5,000 song tunes and texts, which is quite a lot really in the scheme of things, and over not that long a period of time. He was collecting in England, particularly in Somerset, and also went over to America, to the Appalachians, and collected what he considered to be English folk songs that were being sung over there.
And why has he become the most sort of celebrated figure and the kind of the linchpin of the whole revival?
Well, not only was he very active in collecting work, but he also promoted the collecting work. He was very vocal about folk songs' importance and, you know, writing into the national papers and trying to encourage others as well to become collectors. So when the Folk Song Society first started, there was a flurry of collecting, but it started to wane and tail off. And Cecil Sharp sort of pointed this out and encouraged them to start collecting again and become much more active.
In his iconic book, English Folk Song, Sung Conclusions, published in 1907, Sharp describes England's folk music culture and issues a call to arms.
Only those, perhaps, who have been brought into close contact with the old folk singers of today can fully realise how intimately folk singing and folk dancing have, in the past, been bound up with the social life of the English village. It becomes, therefore, a matter of the highest importance that not only the songs, but all things that relate to the art of folk singing should be accurately recorded while there is yet the time and opportunity. They, one and all, form part and parcel of a great tradition that stretches back into the mists of the past in one long, unbroken chain, of which the last link is now, alas, being forged.
Like many of the early collectors, Cecil Sharp was a composer. He wasn't just collecting songs because he believed they needed saving. He and others thought they could use folk melodies to forge a new music that was authentically British.
The early song collectors were influenced by a few different movements. There were these antiquarians who were interested in the old songs and considered them to be dying out. So they were concerned about preserving them, making sure that they were recorded before they were lost forever. And also at the same time, there was this other movement going on with what we call the English musical Renaissance. England was being described as the land without music. So we had composers such as Hubert Parry and Charles Villiers Stamford who were hoping to create a music that was quintessentially English in sound. So in order to do that, where did they turn to for their inspiration? They turned to the folk music of England and they went out to collect that music so that they could use it to directly inspire and influence their own musical compositions.
Now there was a no miller in Derbyshire did dwell. He had three sons which you shall hear, the old miller live well.
Composers like Ralph Vaughan Williams turned the folk songs they were encountering into refined compositions, a world away from the originals, which were only ever sung by a single singer, free from any instrumentation.
My father, he left me an acre of land. Sing hey, oh, sing ivy. My father, he left me an acre of land and a bunch of green holly and ivy.
An acre of land, sung there by Shropshire singer Fred Jordan, sounds very different when Vaughan Williams gets his hands on it.
My father left me an acre of land.
I will sing ivory.
My father left me an acre of land
and a bunch. bunch of green holly and ivy.
I ploughed it with a ram's horn.
Steve Rowd is a librarian and a veritable encyclopedia when it comes to traditional music and folklore. He raises an interesting point about the motivations of the early collectors.
In some ways, the folk song revival is the wrong word, revival, especially for the first wave of collectors. What they didn't want to do was to perpetuate the way the old people sang. They wanted to perpetuate the songs themselves, especially the tunes. They were really mostly interested in the tunes. What they wanted was to take those songs and use them to revitalize British musical culture. By that, they meant middle-class culture. So when they sang the songs to each other, they would sing to a piano accompaniment, as we call it now, folk music in evening dress.
Where are you going to, my pretty fair maid? Red rosy cheeks and coal black hair.
I'm wooing a milking queen, there she handed me for roving in the dew, makes the milkmaid fair.
Whilst these classical renderings might sound disconnected from the song's origins, I think we should be eternally grateful to the pioneering collectors. Without their efforts, there's no knowing how many songs would have been lost forever. Their work's all the more remarkable when you remember that they had to painstakingly transcribe each song by hand. However, technology was about to change all that. In the Vaughan Williams Memorial Library with Laura Smith, I was lucky enough to come face to face with the piece of kit that would revolutionise the practice of song collecting. Sitting on the table is the Edison phonograph, and it's the kind of wooden box with the wax cylinder reel and a metal horn. And it's such beautiful but rudimentary technology, and it's incredible that this was the beginning of the recording industry. Yet, in many ways, you know, it played a very significant role in song collecting, folk song collecting. Laura, can you tell me about the advent of recording technology and how it was viewed by the early song collectors?
England was pretty late, actually, to using technology, recording technology in their folk song collecting. If you look at other countries such as America and Russia, they had been using sound recordings to capture folk song performances. Whereas in England, it wasn't something that really took off until Percy Grainger started doing his recordings. Some of the collectors in the Folk Song Society did have a go with the Edison phonograph, but they didn't really like it.
Percy Grainger was an Australian-born classical musician whose passion for folk music prompted him to join the collecting rush in 1905 when he was only 23. Out of all the early collectors, he was the most ardent advocate of the phonograph, which he used extensively from 1906 onwards. The recordings he made onto wax cylinders, scratchy and distorted though they are, offer us a vital window into the past.
Come round and roll me over, come roll the cabs down.
Many collectors were suspicious of the phonograph, arguing that it distorted the singer's voice, leading to unscientific results. Thankfully, the technology caught on. One of the principal benefits that recordings offered was the ability to slow the songs down. Doing so revealed the immense skill of the singers, whose performances were filled with trills and ornamentation that wowed the classically trained Percy Grainger. He became fascinated by the minutiae of each performance, noting down the tiny variations in pitch and tempo that the other collectors ignored. Many collectors began to record the singers they met. The fact that very few of these recordings survive is indicative of the collectors' motives, as folk music expert Steve Rowd explains.
The collectors didn't see the recordings as for posterity. They weren't doing it so we could hear them now. They were doing it as a tool to understand the music and to write it down. So the phonograph cylinders weren't really looked after, because once they'd transcribed, they didn't need them anymore. And that's why so few have survived. They didn't think about recording as a way of, you know, echoing down the generations, whereas now we take that for granted.
As the 20th century progressed, everything was about to change. The onset of the First World War had a devastating impact on traditional music and dance in Britain, with a decimated generation losing an untold number of singers and songs. Understandably, the interwar years were a fallow period for song collecting. However, the Second World War was in part responsible for a second folk music revival from the mid-1940s.
The Second World War is billed as the People's War, and it's official that it is the People's War. And there's all those films saying, you know, how it's the British people who are soldiering on through the Blitz and so on that are going to win this war and dig for victory and all of that. It's a very strong message that it's the people that matter. And there's other movements going, you know, back to the land kind of things. Again, echoing the late 19th century thing, if you like, that real England is the rural England. Real England is old. It's not the modern cities and stuff. So those sorts of feelings are all sort of swirling around. I think the BBC should get the credit for putting the first toe in the water, as it were, with their folk song and dialect survey.
In 1952, the BBC established the Folk Music and Dialect Recording Scheme, which was their attempt to document the authentic voices and songs of people across Britain. Reg Hall is an expert musician who spent years studying traditional music.
The aim was to build a library, and the purpose of the library was for reference. Evidence shows that they didn't really like broadcasting it. And the idea was that musicians who had to write music to accompany a play, and the play was about Norfolk, they would take out the Norfolk recordings, get the spirit of Norfolk, then write a classical piece. The idea was that singers would be singing in dialect in their accent, and the actors could imitate the accents.
So in an interesting sort of way, the BBC is sort of half in the old world as being songs collected purely for classical interpretation, moving towards the more archiving and, you know, a public fund to be listened to and used in other ways. So it's a sort of bridging that in that evolution.
I think you're right.
Now come all you jovial fellas, come listen to my song. It is a little ditty and it won't contain you long.
The BBC's most prolific collector was Peter Kennedy. Over the course of his career, he recorded over 550 singers and performers. The BBC went on to use his recordings as the basis of the groundbreaking radio series As I Roved Out, broadcast between 1953 and 1958.
This is the BBC live programme.
As I roved out on a May morning, on a May morning right early, I met my love upon the way, oh Lord, but she was early.
Interestingly, the early BBC producers felt they needed to present the songs recorded in the field in sanitised form, sung by professional singers like Isla Cameron.
Well, as far as we can ever be said to have had a hit number in these programmes, I think the song called Still I Love Him comes nearest to it. The song as we originally played it was found by Peter Kennedy in Norfolk. It's sung now by Isla Cameron with one or two extra verses supplied by listeners.
When I was single, I wore a black shawl. Now I've got married, I've nothing at all. Still I love him, I forgive him. I'll go with him wherever he goes.
This strategy may have made the music more easily digestible for the great British public, but for listeners like folk singer and song collector Shirley Collins, these polished pieces just didn't sit right.
My sister Dolly and I used to listen to As I Roved Out every Sunday, I think it was on, when we were kids, and just heard these songs. And I do remember that some of them were sung with piano accompaniment by a trained singer. And even then, even as a sort of 15-year-old, I thought, no, that's not quite right. The energy of the songs often goes when you set them to a piano arrangement. It does emasculate them in a way. And what it also does is take it away from the working class, you know, saying, yeah, you might have sung it in the first place, but we've got it now, and this is what we're going to do with it. And that really is quite a crime, don't you think?
I agree. I think that you use the word emasculation. I think that's very true. The fact that they're taken away and, you know, suddenly...
The rough edge is knocked off and it's all smoothed out and just made less interesting. But, of course, we have to be grateful to them for, you know, collecting it all, for finding it all.
Eventually, the voices of the original singers, rich in dialect, accent and character, began to filter onto the airwaves, introducing the nation to a massively diverse range of indigenous song. For Shirley, this was a revelation.
When you heard an unaccompanied singer, or perhaps the Copper family had come on, then you suddenly were aware of how wonderful it was in the right hands, in the right voices. And it was never middle-class music, it was always working-class music.
You will see the poor tradesmen walking the street from morning till night for employment to seek.
Another key broadcaster of traditional music in the 1950s was the Texan song collector Alan Lomax. A powerhouse of a man, he'd been forced to flee his native land, accused of communist sympathies during the McCarthy era. He spent some of his time in exile recording singers and performers across the British Isles.
As I walked over London Bridge one midsummer's morning early, and there I beheld a fair lady lamenting for a Georgie.
I suppose that Alan wanted to record to trace back the roots of the music that he knew in the States, particularly the mountain music, because he knew that most of it had come from the British Isles. So I think he was investigating that as well to see what still remained here of what was still quite prolific in certain regions in the States. But I think there was a romance about it as well. He had this view that here was the source of it all, which in many ways, of course, it was. And he wanted to find that. Alan had a great impact in Britain as well because, you know, not only did he collect, but he also broadcast. He did wonderful programmes. And I remember a wonderful story of Alan was so thrilled at discovering Margaret Barry. He was in Ireland in a street in Dundalk and he heard this voice and a banjo coming from nowhere he couldn't see. And he went round a corner and there was Margaret Barry strumming her banjo and throwing her voice against the wall to make it resound so that other people could, you know, hear it better. And I remember he brought Margaret over to England and to the BBC. They had him on one of their programmes and the producer said, you know, what are you doing inflicting a toothless wild Irish gypsy on the British public? The attitude is, of course, that you can't bring something real in. You know, you have to, if you're going to get a wild Irish gypsy, it's got to be an actor, not the real thing. But we love the real thing, don't we, Sam?
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Shirley, we've been talking about those collectors like Alan Lomax and Peter Kennedy who were collecting during the post-war period, but how did their motivations differ from the earlier collectors like Cecil Sharp and Vaughan Williams?
I think that Cecil Sharp in particular was interested in saving English music and song, but not thinking about the social aspect of it. Whereas I think the later collectors were equally interested in the music, but also the social side of it, the historical side of how the people who sang it lived and were and its connection to the past. Alan particularly was a political person, you know, he was on the side of the working classes, the labouring classes, and was well aware of how, you know, how people had been sort of belittled and ignored, you know, and their music not really paid attention to.
Whilst the second folk music revival had a clear political element, for some enthusiasts like Reg Hall, it was also about fun.
Our motivation was, in Irish terms, the crack. You know, we got the fun out of it, we got excitement. Also thought it was artistic and sensationally exciting and interesting, but no financial motive. I've never made a penny on it. There's no way you could do that.
The second folk revival gathered steam over the 1960s. At its peak, folk clubs sprang up across Britain, filled with the sound of enthusiastic performers who used the music gathered by the collectors as a repertoire. But perhaps inevitably times moved on. As fashion shifted, the revival waned, as did the impetus for collectors to keep searching for new singers.
Perhaps they'd run out of energy.
Hmm.
Because it's hard work. And it's exhausting work. I mean, it's most rewarding work and you meet wonderful people, but it takes it out of you, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And I think I would wish any collector good luck nowadays because it's the devil of a job.
As a singer and lover of the old songs, I'm eternally grateful to the work of the song collectors who went before me. Whatever their motivations for collecting, from revitalising English classical composition using folk melodies to drawing attention to the struggle of the working classes, if it wasn't for their efforts, thousands of ancient songs would have been lost forever. It would be tempting to imagine that after the second folk revival of the 50s, 60s and 70s, the work of the song collectors was over. But as we'll find out in the second episode of this series, nothing could be further from the truth.